give God a hand of praise for these young people. Amen. Song of worship, amen. And we praise God for Brother Will, amen. Over there on the keyboard, God is doing some awesome things. It is just an awesome blessing to see our young folks just praising God, amen. In a time when everything is trying to distract them and pull them away from doing what God would have them to do, it is just a blessing to see them still pressing their way, giving God their songs of worship. Amen. Amen. Praise God for your presence. God is certainly good. Amen. And again, we welcome you to this place. Let's pray. God, we thank you for your goodness and your mercy toward us. God, just as the young people say, that Jesus is real. That's the reason that we are here. And because he is real, you have given us a song of worship. God, you're worthy of praise. You're worthy of honor. You're worthy of glory. For you are good and your mercy endures forever. So God, here we are, and we need to hear from you. We ask right now that you would open up our hearts, Lord, that your word might be deposited deep inside us. God, that we might be to the end, Lord, that our hearts might be changed and that a soul might be saved. God, we thank you and praise you. We come in anticipation of your blessing on this morning. In Jesus' name, amen.
Amen.
Amen. Amen. God is a good God. We have been blessed as we have been going through this journey in 1 John as we looked at the series, Living in the Light, Living in the Light. And we learned on last week that the world don't have no love for us, amen? And we shouldn't have no love for the world, amen? That the world is seeking to pull us back in, and God has already pulled us out of the world, amen? Amen. So this week we continue to press our way in this series, and we're going to look at the continuation of 1 John chapter 2. I'm going to try to wrap up chapter 2. And I'm going to speak from the subject, truth or consequences. Truth or consequences. Got a question before we jump into the scripture. Can someone be sincere in what they believe and be completely wrong? Think about that. Can someone be just sincere, sold out, truly believe it, all in, and be wrong? See, today, people want to say that, look, long as you are sincere in your beliefs, it's all good. Long as you really believe it, you're great. Oh, Nathan, you love Jesus? That's good for you. I'm so happy for you. I hope that works out for you. This sincerity thing is dangerous, amen, in society. Now, sincerity is good. It's good that people are committed and dedicated and truly believe in something. But if you believe it in a lie, there's consequences, amen?
Amen.
If you believe in something that is truly wrong, it's a price to pay, amen?
Amen.
So what we want to do today is find out how can we combat being driven or being pulled away by the lies that are going on today. You know folk lie in church, right? I mean, y'all know that, right? People lie. You know people lie from the pulpit, right? You know people tell stories to kind of draw you in, amen? You know people manipulate, right? In the church. So it's interesting that in 1 John, that he spells out to the church a way they can combat these falsehoods. Let's look at what the scripture says. Let's look at what the scripture says. 1 John chapter 2, 21 through 23. We're going to start there, but we're going to be all over the end of that. 21 through 23. And the word of God says this. I have not written to you because you don't know the truth, but because you do know it, and because no lie comes from the truth. Who is the liar, if not the one who denies Jesus the Messiah? He is the Antichrist, the one who denies the Father and the Son. No one who denies the Son can have the Father. He who confesses the Son has the Father as well. Who is a liar, if not the one who denies Jesus the Messiah? You know, back in the day, there was a show called Truth or Consequences. Many of y'all are not old enough to remember that, amen? But I love the name of the show because in the contest, if you answer truthfully, amen, you got something. If you didn't answer truthfully, they clowned you. Amen? They made jokes. This show went on for many, many years. Amen? But in the real world, in the Christian world, there is truth. Amen? But when you don't buy into the truth, the consequences aren't funny. That's right. The consequences aren't nothing to laugh at. The consequences are great. As I was looking at these scriptures, and I'm like, oh, Lord, why I got to preach from this, talking about the Antichrist and talking about those who are falling out of faith, all these things. But God reminded me that right here in the church, not this church, but right here in the church, we have those who still deny the Messiah. We have those who still deny the truth of the Word of God. So there's one thing I want you to remember today as we go through this word is that you must remain faithful to the gospel truth. If you don't get anything, if you take a nap for the next few minutes, amen, one thing I want you to remember that as a believer, we must stay faithful to the gospel truth, amen? So let's look at what our brother John says. John says, again, that for, he said this in verse 21, I have not written to you because you don't know the truth, but because you do know it, and because no lie comes from the truth. If you tell a half truth, it's a what?
A lie.
Amen. The truth mixed with a lie is still a what?
A lie.
Amen. So it's no way that lies can dwell in the truth, amen? And the truth stands on its own. The truth doesn't need you to believe it to be the truth. The truth does not need a vote. The truth does not need a majority. The truth don't need you. The truth stands on its own. God's word stands on its own. Listen to what the prolific Christian commentator Warren Wiersbe says. He puts it this way. It makes no difference what you believe, just long as you are sincere. He says that statement expresses the personal philosophy of many people today, but it is doubtful whether most of those who make it have really thought it through. Is sincerity the magic ingredient that makes something true? If so, then you ought to be able to apply it to any area of life and not only religion. Check this out. A nurse in the city hospital gives some medicine to a patient, and the patient becomes violently ill. The nurse is sincere, but the medicine is wrong. A man hears noises in the house one night and decides a burglar is at work. He gets his gun and shoots the burglar, who turns out to be his daughter. Unable to sleep, she has gotten up for a bite to eat. She ends up the victim of her father's sincerity. See, it takes more than sincerity to make something true. Faith in a lie will always cause serious consequences. Faith in truth is never misplaced. It does make a difference what a man believes. If you believe something is wrong, if you believe something in something that is wrong, you will always have dire consequences. We must stand in truth. Sincerity is never the test. Amen? It is impossible for us in this real life to truly stand on a lie. One thing that happens with lies is they always break down.
Yes.
We've been learning. I'm going to tell you this. Let me just put it to you this way. Back in the day, I was a good liar. Amen? You know, I was a good liar. I know that kind of doesn't seem like it goes together. Amen? But, you know, I was a good liar. I can put some together. Y'all know what I'm talking about.
Yeah.
You know, I can weave the stories together and everything. Amen? But always, 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 at some point, the lie would unravel. It is something about lies. You don't need the whole thing to just blow up. All you have left is just one little thing.
Yeah.
Amen?
Yeah.
Lies will always come back to bite you. I love the word of God. It talks about those things that you do in the dark. He will what? Bring to the light. Amen? It's a many a slick brother who thought he was getting over, but the lies collapsed. It's a many a sister that thought she just put that sweet persona on. Amen? But when he got a hold of the cell phone, everything went sideways. Amen? Listen, we must understand that we have to stand on truth. We can never stand on lies. Amen? As we continue our journey through this series in John, Living in the Light, we know we now turn to dealing with the false teachers that had infiltrated the church in perpetrating these lies. These false teachers were dangerous because their teachings were contrary to the gospel message. They taught that Jesus was not the Messiah. They taught that to be spiritual, all you had to do is have some special knowledge. They attempted to draw people away from the truth with their lies. I was at work the other night, and we start having one of those conversations, amen? And one sister was telling this young guy who was infatuated with her that, hey, I'm meant to find you a nice girl. And so somebody who wasn't even part of the conversation jumps in and says, you know, if you want to find a nice girl, you know, you can go to church, and you know, and then they go down that whole aisle. Then one guy says, if you want to find a nice girl, you need to go up to BYU. And the scripture goes, BYU? What are you? Are you Mormon or something? He said, oh, yeah, I am. And then he started on this tirade about Mormonism. He started, right, Mormons do this and Mormons do that, and we're wonderful and blah, blah, blah. He's running all these things that they do. And I said, okay, that's cool. But if you are sincere and fervent about a lie, you are sincerely wrong. He sincerely, I mean, he was passionate about his beliefs. He tried to give us Mormon 101 in 15 minutes, amen? And I can tell, he was like, I've been on my mission, I went to seminary 4 years, amen? I got married in the temple, I mean, he was doing all the stuff that, you know, Mormons check off the list. But he got a problem, because what they believe is wrong. See, you can be sincere, and you can be wrong, and there's dire consequences to it, amen? I know for the church, this is not an easy pill to swallow. But the thing we must understand is that we must remain faithful to the gospel truth. Does it make a difference what we believe? Absolutely, it makes a difference what we believe. Listen, we're living in dire times, amen? The last hour is right around the corner. We're living in the last times. And there are those who are seeking to get us to deny the master of the universe, to deny our Savior, amen? It is vitally important that we know and believe the truth and be able to detect the lies when they come our way. Amen?
Amen?
When we look at John's epistle here, as we finish up 1 John chapter 2, we find out that there's three marks of a false teacher that we need to understand when we're looking at the truth. See, the problem is that many of us are seeking God.
We're seeking God, but we want God on our terms. Right. While we were having that same conversation, the lady who started the conversation says, you know, I don't understand all this, you know, religious stuff. You know, it just seems like it was right. Why we got so many ways? Why we got so many ways to God? Why we got so many religions? Amen. Why we got so many beliefs? You know, I don't believe everything in the Bible. You believe everything in the Bible? I said, yeah, I believe everything in the Bible. And I told her, I said, listen, we are in this flesh. We are born in sin, shaped in iniquity. And one thing about man is that this flesh always seeks to try to bring order. Amen. And sometimes when we seek to bring order, we're not seeking what's best for us. We're seeking what fits us.
Right, right.
See, what's best for us is to surrender to the one who sent his son who died on the cross for us. But what we like is what fits for us. Amen. I heard one preacher, he called it, we like the spiritual smorgasbord. Amen. We like to cherry pick the Bible. We like to grab a little this over there. Oh, wait a minute. I like this scripture because it don't talk about what I'm doing. Amen. But see, when we truly, truly believe, we must remain faithful to the truth.
Yeah.
And what we've learned in our studies thus far in the sermon series is that when you remain in the truth, it shows that we truly have a relationship with God. Amen?
Amen.
So let's look at the word. Let's look at these marks of a false teacher. A false teacher departs from fellowship, denies the faith, and tries to deceive the faithful. He departs from the fellowship, denies the faith, and tries to deceive the faithful. Let's look again what the scripture said. John says this in verse 18 again. Children, it is the last hour. And as you have heard, Antichrist is coming. Even now, many Antichrists have come. We know from this it is the last hour. They went out from us, but they did not belong to us. For if they had belonged to us, they would have remained with us. However, they went out so that it might be made clear that none of them belong to us. That's a hard pill to swallow. He says that the Antichrist has come. You've heard the Antichrist is coming. When he talks about the Antichrist that is coming, he is talking about that one who is coming in the latter days. Amen. But here I want to concentrate on the Antichrist that are already here. Amen. When he says us, he is referring to the church, the fellowship of believers. Listen, not everyone who is a part of an assembly of believers is necessarily a member of the family of God. Every person that has their name on the roster of some church don't have their name written in the Lamb's Book of Life. There is folks who will sit up in church Sunday after Sunday, decade after decade, going to bust hell wide open.
Preach.
Oh, I said it. Amen. He says that there are many antichrists. They are here right now. See, the New Testament presents the church in a twofold way. It is the worldwide family of faith, and there is the local assembly of believers. Amen? So you have the universal church, and you have the local church. Every believer in Jesus Christ belongs to the universal church. Amen? Some like to say it's the invisible church. Because you know why it's invisible? Because you can never count the roster by just looking at the people in the pew. See, God has a heavenly roster. He knows who really belong to the faith. I've shared a story about a young woman who was part of the Calvary Chapel ministry. She had served some 4 years in the ministry, and she was out on this outreach that they had, and you know, they were out doing the thing. They were ministering to people and serving the people, amen. And the pastor happened to be out there with her, and she turns to the pastor. Hey, pastor, I think I'm ready. I think I'm ready. And I may have shared this before. And he goes, you think you're ready? Ready for what? I think I'm ready to give my life to Christ. He goes, ooh, wait a minute. You never gave your life to Christ? You're not a Christian? She says, no.
He says, wait a minute, you've been working in the church for 4 years.
Amen.
She says, yeah, because I like the fellowship. I like the you know, the message. I like the you know, the songs. I like the outreach. I like all that stuff, but I've never had a relationship with Jesus Christ. God just touched my heart right now. See, there's many folk who do work in church, who preach in church, who usher in church, who deacon in church, who do all kind of stuff in church that don't have their name written in the Lamb's Book of Life. See, when you look at the Word of God, you have to remain in the truth. He says that they went out from us because they were never of us. Listen, when a truth sinner, when a sinner trusts Christ as Savior, he receives eternal life and immediately becomes a member of God's family and a part of Christ's spiritual body. He should then identify with a local group of believers, amen, and start serving Christ. But the point here is that a person can belong again to the local church and not be a part of the spiritual body, amen. See, you can come and fill out a connection card and turn it in to Brother Arn, and you know, you can say, you know, write down your talents. You can come to new members class, amen. I can connect you with a servant leader, amen, and you can be a part of that team and have no Jesus on the inside.
Amen. My Lord.
Truth has consequences. We must stand on the truth, amen. One of the evidences of true Christian life is the desire to be with the people of God. We know that we have passed from death unto life because we love the brethren. That's 1 John 3:14. When people share the same divine nature and are indwelt by the same Holy Spirit, they want to enjoy fellowship and they want to share with one another. Amen? Listen, I used to run the streets. I mean, run the streets tough. When you talk about partners, I had partners. You know, we go to the club, we 20 deep, amen? I just love hanging with them, but you know what we had in common? The streets. You know what we had in common? The stuff we like to do. But we know what we had in common? Just acting like knuckleheads, amen? But something about when God changed my life, amen, he changed my crowd. He changed the folk that I ran with, amen? And I'm going to tell you this, I love being in church. I love being with my brothers. I love being with the sisters of Christ. Amen. I got some partners, amen, that God has given me. I love hanging out with them. And guess what? We saved, but we still play dominoes. We saved, but we still like the action movie. Amen. We saved, but we still kind of clown each other. Amen. But we share in common the Holy Spirit that indwells us and endears us to one another. Amen? I don't understand people who don't like hanging around the saints. Now, don't get me wrong. There's some folk in church, boy, make you question your Jesus. Amen? But if you've got the Holy Spirit inside you, I want to be with the people of God. Amen? I'm going to be with them for eternity. I might as well get some good practice in right now. Amen? Jesus tells us in his word that they shall know you by the love you have one for another. Amen? So if we can't love one another, how are we going to tell the world, come on in, we're going to love you. Y'all don't even like each other. You don't even want to hang with each other. Amen? Fellowship. So those folk who walked away from the fellowship showed that they didn't have a relationship with him. Now listen, I'm not talking about no temporary interruption. Let me clarify that. Because some of us believers, we get some temporary interruptions in our fellowship. Temporary interruptions happen sometimes when you get your feelings hurt. I ain't going to church. Temporary interruptions happen when you go through a tough time in your life and you break fellowship. But check this out. If you truly a believer and you truly belong to a church that loves God, when you have your temporary interruptions, we going to try to interrupt your mess.
Yes.
We're going to come get you. Amen? We're going to love you back into the flock if you want to be loved back. And those who have temporary interruptions, God usually steps in and says, okay, your pity party is over. It's time for you to come home. Your pity party is done.
it's time to come home. See, because if you truly in a relationship with God, the scripture tells us, there is nothing that can separate you from his love. There is nothing. Nothing you can do, nothing nobody else can do, nothing the enemy can do, because if you truly belong to God, you are his child. It reminds me of the prodigal son. Some of you know the story because you actually read the Bible. Amen? The prodigal son is this brother whose daddy was loaded. Amen? Pops had cash. And this prodigal son couldn't wait on his inheritance. You know how some of us are. You know, they got the money right there. Let me have it right now. Amen? And so Pop says, you know what? Here, take your money. I got you. Go. Amen? And he goes, and what does he do? He goes to the club. Amen? He buying all the liquor. He you know, wasting it on women. Amen? He go buy a nice car and everything. And we know what happens when you get money fast, right? Because some of y'all have been fast money rich. Amen? And just as being quick and poor. Amen? You go spend the money up. So the prodigal son spends the money up. Amen? And he's living in squalor. Then he remembers. My daddy got all this. He got everything I need. Amen? So all I'm going to do is ask him to forgive me and, you know, and throw myself out. I work in this field. I do the menial job. I just want to be back in my father's house. And what's so amazing about that story, when the prodigal son makes his way to the house, Pops come running to him. Arms wide open, embrace him right while he's still stinking, smelling, with all the world and filth on him. Because when you are a son, it is nothing you can do to change your relationship. You are a son. If Jeremiah went out kicking up dust all over the world, it's nothing that he can do that can change the fact that I'm his father and he's my son. And that's how God feels about us. It's nothing you can do that can separate you from his love. And he will pursue you. Amen. He will pursue. You know how we do. Some folk, they mess up. We like, you done, dude. Go on about your business. God will pursue us because he loves us. Amen. So when we talk about a mark of those who are false teachers, they slide on out. Amen. And usually when they slide out, you can see the slime on the floor. Amen? They left us because they weren't part of us. Amen? Warren Wisby calls these counterfeit Christians. Wow. You know some counterfeits. Folk who, hey, God bless you, my sister. May the Lord richly bless you. God bless you, my sister. How you doing today? God is so good. Hey, my brother. How you doing, man? You know Jesus? Why they just slipping and sliming their way through and seeking to devour those that are in the flock. Amen? They know the words. Amen? You know, they know the language. They know how to do all the things. They know how to say hallelujah. They know the song Jesus is real. Amen? They know all that stuff. But they are false. And as soon as they gain your confidence, then the lie slides in. Amen? They're counterfeits. Amen? So when we talk about these remaining faithful, again, to the truth, the gospel truth, we must be on the lookout for those who are running away from fellowship. Amen? So we must remain faithful to the gospel truth. So not only do we need to look out for those who run away from the faith, we need to look out for definitely for those who deny the faith. Let's look at what the scripture says. Verse 20 through 25 says this. But you are not like that. For the Holy One has given you his spirit. And all of you know the truth. So I'm writing to you not because you don't know the truth, but because you know the difference between truth and lies. Verse 22. And who is a liar? Anyone. Who says that Jesus is not the Christ. Anyone who denies the Father and the Son is an antichrist. Anyone who denies the Son doesn't have the Father either. But anyone who acknowledges the Son has the Father also. So you must remain faithful to what you've been taught from the beginning. If you do, you will remain in fellowship with the Son and with the Father. And in this fellowship, we enjoy the eternal life he promised us. See, the key question that rises from those verses I just read is, who is Jesus Christ? See, because many people claim to have Jesus, but not the Jesus of the Bible. Like some folks like to say, my Mormon friend, he knows Jesus Christ because he knows the name Jesus Christ because he's part of the Church of Latter-day Saints of Jesus Christ. Amen? They believe in a Jesus Christ, but not the Jesus Christ of the Bible. They believe in the Jesus Christ that is the spirit brother of Lucifer, the one who was also a created being that was that used to be in heaven and not truly a God. Amen? That is a wrong teaching. So we also have those who what do you do with Jesus, my Jehovah Witness friends? My Jehovah Witness friends, and I say that very loosely, say that Jesus Christ is a God. That means he is a created God. Well, last time I checked, the Bible says that God is self-existent. He is self-existent. He's always been. Amen. There's never been a time when there was no God. And Jesus Christ is God. Not a God. The scripture says that all things were created through him and for him and by him.
Amen.
See, it does matter what you do with Jesus and who you say Jesus is. I like Jesus. He's a good teacher. He's a moral teacher. He's a good example. Well, he don't call himself a good example. He calls himself God. He says, I am that I am. Amen? He calls himself God. And not only does he call himself God, the ones who follow him call him God. Amen? Thomas, the one who don't believe nothing. Y'all all got a friend named Thomas. Doubting Thomas don't believe nothing. I ain't gonna believe. You say you got some money. I ain't gonna believe it till I see it. You got a new car. Where is it? Let me drive it. Let me touch it. Amen? You know we got those kind of people in our life. They don't believe nothing unless they see it. Amen? Thomas was that way. He said, listen, they said, Thomas, Jesus has risen, amen. Jesus is alive. He's like, I ain't gonna believe it till I can put my fingers in the hole and put my hand in his side. And then guess what? Jesus shows up and Thomas sees Jesus. He said, come on. Thomas falls to his knees and he said, my God. And he says to Thomas, listen, you believe? Because you see. But more blessed are those who believe and yet have not seen. Amen. We believe that Jesus is the Christ. We believe that Jesus is the Messiah. And if anybody teaches anything else, they are liars. Amen. I love how the Apostle John puts it. Amen. He just said it's a lie. You know, we like to sugarcoat stuff, make it political. You're wrong. You know, you're mistaken in your assertion. That Jesus is not God. You know what? Maybe you need to do some more research. John just said, no, dude, you a liar. Amen. The word of God says Jesus is Lord. And I love this scripture. It talks about the fact that when you have the Father, you have the Son. And when you have the Son, you have the Father. Amen. Because they're not mutually exclusive. Amen. You cannot have a relationship with the Father unless you come through the Son. Amen? So it is. What do you do with Jesus? Amen? Some preachers, they like to do this. They say, hey, on Judgment Day, the question is going to be, what did you do with my Son? What did you do with my Son? Did you accept this gift or not? Amen? And if you try to come and give God some false testimony, you're in trouble. Because Jesus is the Christ. He is the Messiah. These false teachers seek to deny Christ. Amen. False Christians in John's day used two special words to describe their experience. They say knowledge and unction. They claim to have a special unction or anointing from God, which gave them a unique knowledge. They were illuminated, amen, and therefore living on a much higher level than anybody else, amen. You know, those are the people in the church that, you know, we have a special relationship with God. I know you talk about this Jesus stuff, but you got to have a special anointing, amen, to truly know God. No. We all come the same way, amen, through the cross, amen. They claim this special unction that gave them this great experience, this relationship with the Father. But you cannot have a relationship with the Father unless you go through the Son. John points out that all true Christians know God and have received the Spirit of God. There's no special section for super Christians. We all get the same Spirit, amen? I know that some folk walk around with halos and wings on, but the only way to come through Christ, come to the Father, is through the Son. And when we come to the Son, we all get the same Holy Spirit. You don't get a special high-octane Holy Spirit. While everybody else is on 87, you got 91. Amen. We get the same Holy Spirit. Amen. The great assertion of faith is that sets Christians apart from others is simply the fact that Jesus Christ is God and come in the flesh. That's what sets us apart. Not that we have some kind of special anointing that's different than any other believers. We need to stand on God's word. If we remain in the truth, remain faithful to the truth, amen, then God will continue to bless us. Listen to this. Not all preachers and teachers who claim to be Christians are really Christians in their beliefs. If they confess that Jesus Christ is God, come in the flesh, then they belong to the true faith. If they deny Christ, then they belong to Antichrist. They are in and of the world and not like us true believers that who are called out of the world. When they speak, the world, our unsaved people hear them and believe them. But the unsaved world can never understand a true Christian. Amen. Because we learn that these things are understood spiritually. Amen. A Christian speaks under the direction of the Spirit of truth. A false teacher speaks under the influence of the spirit of error, the spirit of Antichrist. See, you understand why I said this section is a little difficult, amen? We don't want to hear nothing about no Antichrist. But listen, it's Antichrist wearing crosses and in churches every day, denying Christ with their little subtle, slick ways, amen? Making Jesus some holy puppet, amen? Instead of being the God that he is, instead of being the Savior that he is, instead of being the Lord that he is, amen?
Amen.
Jesus is the Christ, amen?
Amen?
To confess that Jesus Christ is God come in the flesh involves much more than simply to identify with Christ. Mark 1:24 talks about, listen, even the demons knew him, amen? Jesus will cast out demons and be like, hey, we know you. Amen? So if the demons know him and are not saved, it's folk who claim to know him that don't really have a relationship with him. Amen? That's just like me saying, hey, I'm no Kobe Bryant. I know Kobe. You tell me I'm no Kobe. You gonna tell me I'm no Kobe? If I see him, hey, Kobe. But that ain't the kind of, I don't have a relationship with Cody, amen? It's folk who know about Jesus. They heard of Jesus. They think they seen the pictures. They read the book, amen? But they have no relationship with him. See, this knowledge, this comes with relationship, amen? What sets us apart as believers is that we have relationship with him. Amen. I've been married to my wife 23 years come December. Amen. And it would be a travesty to marriage if for those 23 years I just said, hey, I know Deidre. I live somewhere else. We don't hang out, but I know her. And you know what? I even claim her as my wife. But that's not marriage. Marriage is based on
relationship. Not just knowledge, but relationship. See, God just doesn't want you to know his name. He wants a relationship with you. Because the scripture tells us that he's married to us, the church. Amen? He's married to the church. He wants an intimate relationship with us. Amen? He lavished his love on us. God is like that one who, you know, sister, some of y'all husbands used to do it, you know. Just was chasing after you and just lavishing his love on you. Just taking care of me, overwhelming you with his love. That's how God is to his church. Amen? But see, just like, you know, some of you ladies, you don't always receive the love.
I know I'm getting in trouble today. Maybe I should change that up. They in the manuscript. Amen. Y'all, forgive me for that. Amen. The brothers are looking at me like, you talk about us one more time. You better say something about them women. Amen. Listen. George Whitefield, the great British evangelist, was speaking to a man about his soul. He asked the man, sir, what do you believe? I believe what my church believes, the man replied respectfully. And what does your church believe? The same thing I believe. And what do both of you believe? The preacher inquired again. We both believe the same thing. Listen, a man is not saved by assenting to a church creed or signing some membership statement or attending some class. He is saved by trusting Jesus Christ and bearing witness to his faith. You cannot be a believer and deny Christ. You can only be a believer by having a saving relationship with Jesus Christ. The false teacher denies the faith. If you ever bump into somebody who does not, who claims to know Jesus but yet denies him as the Messiah, they're a liar. They're of the Antichrist. We must trust that God is the one who sent his son, who gave his very life on the cross. We must trust the words that are in this holy writ that God left for us, amen, so that we can trust in the one who saves. Cannot deny the faith. Not only does the false teacher bail on the fellowship, deny the faith, he tries to deceive the faithful. Wow. Let's look at what these last few verses say. 1 John 2:26-29 says this. I'm writing these things to warn you about those who want to lead you astray. But you have received the Holy Spirit, and he lives within you. So you don't need anyone to teach you what is true. For the Spirit teaches you everything you need to know. And what he teaches is true. It is not a lie. So just as he has taught you, remain in fellowship with Christ. Verse 28. And now, dear children, remain in fellowship with Christ, so that when he returns, you will be full of courage and not shrink back from him in shame. The false teacher tries to deceive the faithful. Amen. He tries to deceive the faithful. Verse 29. Since we know that Christ is righteous, we also know that all who do what is right are God's children. Amen. It's interesting to observe that the anti-Christian groups rarely try to lead sinners to their false faith. Instead, they spend much of their time trying to convert professing Christians and church members at that to their own doctrine. They are out to seduce the faithful. Have you noticed that if you ever encounter a Jehovah's Witness at your door, and you are armed and dangerous believer. When I say armed and dangerous, that means you're not afraid to open the door. That means you, when you open the door with your word, ready to talk. Amen? But what they do is they already have scriptures that they are already been pre-selected to do battle with believers. Amen? They're not seeking to convert the lost. They're seeking to undermine your beliefs and bring you into the faith. Listen, the devil ain't concerned about people who lost. They already on the team. Y'all know that, right? He's not concerned about the unbeliever. Why would he spend all his efforts with them? They already on the squad. But those who have come into the light from the darkness, his job is to deter you from growing in Christ. Let me share this little secret with you. If you truly believe, if you're a true believer, there's nothing the devil can do to snatch you out of God's kingdom. But what he does is he tries to make you so impotent in your faith that you cannot produce other disciples. He wants to destroy your witness. You know, he wants you, don't share your testimony. You share your testimony, they don't know what happened. If you share your testimony, they don't know where you've been and what kind of person you used to be. You better keep your mouth shut. But God forgave me of all that. Yeah, he forgave you, but he ain't forgot. Don't believe that. And if you tell these people, they really ain't going to forget. He wants to make you impotent. He wants to tell you you have nothing to offer. What kind of church going to use you? Amen? What kind of church going to use you? You know what kind of person you are. You don't even like people. How are you going to serve in the church? Amen? He puts these lies together so that he can attack the faithful. Some of you know I'm telling the truth. Because you have been unctioned by the Holy Spirit to share your story right now. Tell it. And you're like, I ain't gonna tell. I don't know this folk. You might think I'm crazy. Lord, you couldn't pick a better place. You'd be like, get some chairs and some soft music, some candles or something. Just set the mood a little bit, Lord. You're like, no, tell it now. In the elevator? Amen. On the job, they already think I'm crazy. Amen. But we must understand the enemy is trying to destroy your witness. Amen. When Peter was with Christ right before he was crucified, amen, they dragged him to court. Peter was off to the side. Amen. The enemy tried to destroy Peter's witness. Peter denied Christ. Here's Peter who told Jesus, I'm with you, ride or die. I don't care if they kill me. I'm with you, Jesus. I'm damned. And they came and arrested him. He was like, oh, wait a minute. They getting ready to do that to you? They might get me like that. And he shrunk back. Amen? But so, this is the faithfulness of God, though. Jesus already told him, the devil desires to shit sick you like we. But be encouraged, because I prayed for you. Can you imagine the master of the universe, yeah, the Messiah, telling you, yeah, look, the devil coming after you. Yeah. But be encouraged. I got your back. Amen? Let me tell you this. This is a secret. Nobody else knows. Just tell y'all. Don't tell nobody else. The devil is coming after you. Amen? Some of y'all had that this morning. He was coming after you. You don't need to go down to no church. Hey, just Bedside Baptist is good. The music is good. Amen. Everything is good. Amen. You can worship at the football game. Amen. Some of y'all have the battle. I'm tired. I don't feel like hearing nothing about the people. That's what the devil does. He's subtle and slick. Amen. To try to distract us from what God has for us. Amen. So when you go and you try to tell somebody about Jesus, you can't even do it. Amen. Because he wants to destroy your witness. He wants to deceive the believers. It says this, the word seduce carries the idea of being led astray. We have been warned that this would happen. Listen, this is 1 Timothy 4:1. We have been warned that this would happen. Now the Spirit speaketh expressingly, that in the latter times some shall depart from the faith, giving heed to seducing spirits and the teachings of demons. Seducing spirits. Those things that will lure you away from the fellowship of faith. Jesus called Satan the father of what? Lies. The devil's purpose is to lead Christians astray
by teaching them false doctrines. Listen, we should not accept everything a person tells us simply because he claims to believe the Bible. For it is possible to twist the Bible to make it mean almost anything. Amen. You come to Sunday school, we'll teach you about that. Amen.
Amen.
And it's called scripture twisting. I fell in love with this new show. You know, I like TV shows, especially any crime drama. How to Get Away with Murder. Man, that's a new addiction, amen, like that. Wow. At first, I didn't want to look at it because I'm like, that don't even sound good, amen. But one thing I've learned and it kind of solidified for me is that some folk will do anything to win.
Yeah.
See, the devil is like that attorney
that
will say anything, amen, to try to draw you away from the truth, to try to muddy the waters, amen? And see, that's how Satan is. He wants to say anything to muddy the waters. He is the father of lies. Listen, if he even tried to lie to Jesus, check this out. He goes to Jesus at a time when Jesus is vulnerable. He's been praying 40 days, fasting, no food, no water. He comes off the fast and boom, here comes Satan. Amen. And what Satan does, he does with Jesus, he tries to take his own word and use it out of context. Amen. You know, he did the same thing with Eve. Y'all know, sister, did the Lord truly say that you cannot partake from that tree? Amen. He is a liar. When you know somebody is a liar, what do you do with them? That's a rhetorical question for you. I got a friend named Rico, that's his AKA, amen? And this brother is a habitual liar. I know he's lying when his mouth is moving, amen? So whenever Rico says anything to me, I already know that 9 times out of 10, it's a lie. So when we know that the devil is a liar, why would we even give him our ear? Amen?
Amen.
So we must stand on the truth and the truth alone. Amen? Amen. Satan is the one that counterfeits. He is a counterfeit minister who preaches a counterfeit gospel, who produces counterfeit Christians, who depend on a counterfeit righteousness. In the parable of the tares, Jesus and Satan are pictured as sowers, amen? Soon as God sows some good seed, Satan tried to sow some bad seed. Soon as God, you know, how many of you, just think about this. Think about the moment you surrendered your life to Christ, amen? Now let me get you, for you all that aren't believers here. When you get saved, there's not going to appear a harp up here that starts to play. It's not going to be like roses all of a sudden come down the aisle, amen? You're not going to see the angels literally clapping. When you give your life to Christ, it was a spiritual change. But check this out. Just think about this. How did some things start happening in your life when you gave your life to Christ? Certain things start happening. Certain people will start not liking you no more. You say, hey, I'm saved. God gave my life to Christ. He's changed me. And they're like, man, you lunatic, get away from me. The devil starts to get busy, amen. Soon as you say, Lord, I'm committed, I'm going to tithe. Amen. Then the car breaks down. You know what I'm saying? The air conditioner at the house ain't working, amen. Something happens. Lord, I'm committed to go to Bible study. Then he changed your schedule at work. Amen. The enemy, he will play there. Amen? But we got to remain in the truth. Recognize a liar for what he is. And how do we combat? A lie with the truth.
Right.
So when the devil starts messing with you, when he starts messing with what you're doing, you say, God, I'm committed to you. I'm going to stand with you. God, I'm trusting you. You're going to work it out. Amen?
Right.
I'm going to put my trust in you. I'm going to put my hand in your hand. I'm rolling with you. Amen? Because
right.
The devil always wants to distract us.
Yeah.
Amen.
Amen.
So how does a believer defend against these false teachers? How does a believer deal with those who want to deceive them? We deal with them by remaining faithful to the gospel of truth. See, it is only God's word in your heart, in your mind, in your spirit that will help you combat the enemy. If you think you that bad that you can handle the devil on your own, then you are sorely mistaken. Now listen, some folk talk crazy, but the devil ain't no punk. Amen? Understand this, you better make sure you got your weapons right, amen, when you go to battle with him. Now the scripture tells us, greater is he that is in me than he that's in the world. But listen, I got to make sure he in me. I got to make sure the word is in me. I got to make sure I've been spending some time with my Father. I got to make sure I've been spending some time hearing from him, amen. Because we are in a war. So how do you fight? You fight by getting in God's word. You fight by getting in God's face in prayer. You fight by walking out this faith. Amen?
Amen.
You have to remain faithful. Remain faithful to the gospel truth. You have to remain in fellowship with brothers and sisters in Christ. And when you remain faithful in fellowship, and when you remain faithful to the truth, God is always going to remain faithful to you. Amen?
Amen.
Amen. We have to understand that there are truth and consequences. But when we stand on the truth, we know that God is to have the consequences in his hand. Then we can hold on to that promise from Romans chapter 8, 28, where it says, all things work together for the good of those who love God and those who are called according to his purpose. So even though the enemy may throw rocks at you, you can thank thanking God for the rocks, because you know that if the enemy throwing rocks, I know God got me.
Right.
Amen.
Right.
If I'm going through a difficult time, God got me. Right. If my health is strange, if things are going awry, if I truly have a relationship with God, I ain't got to worry about it, because he has me. Amen.
Amen.
Amen. Remain faithful to the gospel truth. Amen.
Amen.
Amen. Amen. Amen. Amen.
I've been moving too fast and not stopping, forgetting to ask where I'm going. I've been crying at night in the darkness, suffering alone in the silence. I've been hiding the pain and the confusion, forgetting who holds all solutions. Trying to rule the world my own way. Now I'm humble enough to say that